So what I will try to do today is to give you an overview of the work I have been doing over the past several months in collaboration with Christina and her colleagues to design a website for FEF chemicals that describes the history of the use of insulin in cell culture and also the mechanisms by which insulin makes cells grow in culture. And like the website, my talk is structured in eight successive sections. In the first one, I'll give a short history of the cell culture media and of the use of insulin to make cells grow. In the second section, I will describe how cells grow and tell you a little bit about the complicated history of the discovery of the insulin-like growth factors. Then I will describe the insulin peptide family and the insulin and IGF-1 receptors. After that, I will try to explain to you the complicated mechanism by which insulin and IGF-1 bind and activate their receptors. Then a bit more complicated section about the signaling pathways whereby insulin and IGF-1 trigger actions inside the cell and where is the specificity which makes insulin and IGF-1 do different things. And I will end up by explaining to you a little bit about the regulation of the cell cycle by insulin and IGF-1 and the regulation of apoptosis, meaning programmed cell death, by insulin and IGF-1. So this is the menu for today. Let's start with a short history of cell culture media and the use of insulin. The ancestors of the cell culture media were the so-called balanced salt solutions, BSS. And the first one was devised in 1885 by a British doctor and a physiologist called Sidney Ringer. And he wanted to study an organ from the body put in survival outside of the body. So he was using frog hearts. And in order to maintain this frog heart, he invented a solution to replace the internal environment that was made obviously of liquid water to provide irrigation, but also salts, ions for metabolism, substances for maintaining the osmotic pressure, glucose as a source of fuel, and so on. Using that, he was able to have a frog heart beat outside of the body for quite a long time, and that was used by many people to study whole organs, ex vivo as it is called. And other such solutions were invented, like for example the phosphate buffer saline invented by Renato Dulbecco, who got the Nobel Prize for his work on reverse transcriptase. He was a virologist. But people started thinking about not taking a whole organ, because that would not last very long, but try to take a piece of tissue and have it try to survive for a long time outside of the body. And the first person to succeed was someone named Ross Harrison, who was working at Johns Hopkins University. And he managed to take tadpole tissue explants and having them grow in a drop hanging under a glass plate in a clotted frog lymph. And doing that, he managed to see neurite expansions in these explants from the tadpoles. And this is Mr. Ross Granville Harrison. Now, someone who heard about this was a French surgeon named Alexis Carrel, who became extremely famous and made cell culture become really a big field. And Alexis Carrel worked in France, then he moved to Chicago, I think in 1902. And got the Nobel Prize in 1912 for nothing to do with cell culture. He had invented a special way to sew together an artery that had been cut. And that was a great advance in surgery that allowed also open heart surgery and other things. That's why he got the Nobel Prize. But he became very interested in tissue culture, and he actually really became the pope of tissue culture and made the cover of Time magazine. And he adopted Harrison's suspension method, but instead of clotted lymph, he replaced this with a balanced salt solution, as well as serum and extract of chick embryos. And doing that, he was able to take chick embryo explants and maintain them in culture for a very long time. And actually, he published 142 papers on cell culture, so he became really the pope of tissue culture for many, many years, actually not always for the best, because he was quite dominant in the field, and he claimed a number of things that proved not to be true. So he managed to maintain a chick embryo for 34 years. Actually, he died before the chick embryo explant, and it was finally extinguished 2 years after his death. But from that, he concluded that you could take cells from a body, and by putting appropriate nutrients like serum and so on, you could make them literally immortal. It turns out not to be true, and in 1965, Leonard Hayflick in the US showed that actually cells taken from the body in the best conditions, in primary culture, they cannot survive for more than 50 divisions. And this has been now called Hayflick's limit. And the reason Carrel's heart explants survived so long was that he was keeping adding chick embryo extracts, which provided probably some new cells, stem cells, into the preparation. And that's what people now suspect was the reason why he was so successful. In any case, that paved the way for tissue culture and cell culture. And it's only in the early 1950s that people managed to establish permanent cell lines. And that cannot be done with primary cells you take from the body. They have to be transformed by something like a virus or UVs or things like that. And cancer cell lines are usually transformed. So one successful one was one established by George Jay. You probably have all heard about the HeLa cell line, which was made from a cervical carcinoma from a lady called HeLa Lacks. And this cell line had been so successful in surviving that it has invaded many cultures of other people who were thinking they were working with a cell line and were in fact working with HeLa cells without knowing it. So you have to be very careful about contamination. But then people started thinking that using serum and as a source of nutrient is not the best thing to do, because serum is a very complicated medium and it contains a lot of nutrients, various amounts of growth factors, and you don't know if one sample of serum will be exactly the same as another. So if you want to really do cell culture in defined conditions, it was better to try to get rid of serum. And one of the first to manage to do that was Harry Eagle, who devised what is called minimum essential medium. There is also the Dulbecco variant that you already know, all known as DMEM, which allowed to make cells growing, and then you could use such media to add other things, more defined growth factor, to see what is really the minimum number of things that you have to put in a medium to make cells grow. And you need to bring not only as in the balanceol solutions, the ions and all those things, vitamins, but various growth factors we know today. At that time they were not known, transferrin, as you know, and other things. So the person who really found a sort of universal solution was Gordon Sato, who was born in 1927. He was a cell biologist at University of California in San Diego, a brilliant scientist. And he's the first one who really studied a large number of cell lines, trying to see what each one really needed to grow optimally, but not with serum. And he found out that they had different requirements. There are cells which like fibroblast growth factors, others which like epidermal growth factor. But he found out that insulin, in fact, could substitute for many growth factors in almost every cell line. And he was the one who really proposed that insulin was a kind of universal growth factor. He said insulin thus far has been found to be stimulating in serum-free medium for the growth of virtually every cell type examined. And I guess that's why you are here today as a company. And this is a picture, in fact, of Gordon Sato, who was also a great humanitarian. He still is. He's very much alive. And he has done a lot of work to fight poverty in developing countries. So that's a bit the history of cell culture and how insulin came to become an important factor for cell culture. Now, I mentioned growth factors. And we know today that there is a multitude of growth factors which have important effects on different types of cells. The first one to be discovered was actually a nerve growth factor, NGF, discovered in 1953 by Rita Levi-Montalcini, who was an Italian-born scientist. She was born in 1909. She's still alive. She's 102 years old, still very active, and still also working in the Italian parliament as a deputy or something. She's very much alive. I don't know which growth factor she's taking, but she and working with her to help purify nerve growth factor was Stanley Cohen, who worked first also like her at Washington University in St. Louis. Stanley Cohen then moved to Vanderbilt University, and he discovered epidermal growth factor. So both of them got the Nobel Prize in 1986, and after that, many other growth factors were discovered, you know, platelet-derived growth factor, FGF, there are many of them. Now, what about what I would like to focus on for the rest of this part is insulin-like growth factors, IGF-1 and IGF-2, because the reason insulin is an important factor for cell culture is because at high concentrations, it will bind to the receptors for IGF-1 and IGF-2, which is called the IGF-1 receptor. And this is something we now know. We didn't know that. They didn't know that at that time. So how were the insulin-like growth factors discovered? Well, that started with the work of William Doherty, also at Washington University. This is William Doherty, Bill Doherty, who was working at Washington University in St. Louis. He was interested in how pituitary growth hormone works. And he had found out that in order to find out how growth hormone makes bones grow, you know, that it makes a child grow, so that's because the bones grow and so on, he had found a method in which you incorporated radioactive sulfate into cartilage. And by measuring the incorporation of this sulfate, you had a measure of how cartilage is growing. And he found out that growth hormone was not in fact acting directly on the cartilage, but was producing a serum factor which indirectly affected the uptake of sulfate in the cartilage. So growth hormone was not acting directly on bone. It produced a factor which he called sulfation factor, and was later called, shortly afterwards, somatomedin. And that triggered a lot of research because various groups like Justin Hall at the Karolinska, Judson Van Wyck in North Carolina, who were some of the leaders in the field, and Linda Fricklund at CABI and so on, were all trying to purify the somatomedins. And they all had a different assay. One was using chick cartilage, and another something else, and different methods. So they managed to purify some fraction, one called somatomedin A, another somatomedin B, another somatomedin C. And I remember very well the endocrine meetings of those days where it was an extremely hot topic and everyone was kind of fighting to say that his somatomedin was better than the other somatomedin. And it became quite confusing. And then Howard Temin, who shares the Nobel Prize with Dulbecco for the reverse transcriptase, also found a factor in rats called multiplication stimulation activity, MSA. So now we had four different somatomedins, and people were trying to purify them and trying eventually to sequence them to find out what kind of proteins they were. And in parallel, there was a group in Switzerland, in Zurich, Rudi Frosch and his colleagues, who were studying also some factors in the serum, but not for their mitogenic properties, not as growth factor. He was trying to find out what was it that made cells take up glucose. And the postulate was that was insulin. At that time, there was no method to measure insulin. It took until the mid-60s to have the radioimmunoassay, which won the Nobel Prize to Roselyn Yalow. But then they had bioassays, and Rudi Frosch devised a very good bioassay to measure glucose incorporation into fat, and using that you could kind of measure how much insulin-like activity was there in serum. But then when the radioimmunoassay became available, Yalow and colleagues found that only about 10% of serum insulin-like activity was actually insulin. 90% was not insulin. And if you used anti-insulin antibodies, you could only block 10% of the insulin-like activity of serum. It was clear there was a substance or substances other than insulin, which in fact had the major part of the insulin-like activity of serum. But that was studying metabolism. But then what I found out was that this fraction, which is not suppressible by insulin antibodies, called NSILA, non-suppressible insulin-like activity, and S is the fraction that is soluble in acid ethanol, which is in fact the origin of the IGFs, as we will see, had a much more potent mitogenic effect, that means cells growth effect, at much, much lower concentration than the metabolic effect. And the reason a posteriori is that these IGFs had very weak activity for the insulin receptor, so you needed a lot to stimulate metabolism, but they were very potent on the IGF-1 receptor, so you needed much less. That was a hint that in fact there was a growth factor there, which happened to have some insulin-like effects at high concentration, but was a potent mitogen. And then the race was on, because that was a new angle to the somatomedin story. And Frösch's group worked for 20 years trying to purify and sequence the NSILAS. They started with 7 tons of fraction 5 of plasma that they got from Hoffmann-La Roche in Basel. And then they made an acetone precipitate. They got 11 kilos of acetone powder. And by various purification steps, they finally got 5 micromoles of something that they could sequence. And when the sequence came out, that was done by Rinderknecht and Humbel in Zurich, it was clear that the sequence was very analogous to the sequence of insulin. There are 2 different factors, then called IGF-1 and IGF-2, insulin-like growth factor 1 and 2, and they were clearly cousins of insulin. There were changes in the sequence, but they were clearly related to insulin. And when finally the cDNA for these IGFs were cloned, and then they could be produced in high amounts, and they were crystallized and studied by NMR, and it became clear that the overall structure, the tertiary structure of these growth factors, is also very similar to that of insulin. And then the other guys started trying to purify their own somatomedins, A, B, and C, and MSA, and it all turned out, when they finally sequenced them, that they were either IGF-1 or IGF-2. So this whole family reduced itself to 2 growth factors, IGF-1 and IGF-2. So that's the history of discovery of these growth factors. So now it became clear that insulin is not a single peptide hormone that exists in isolation. It's part of a big family. And this family, in fact, comprises in humans 10 members. There is insulin, which in the crystal structure exists under 2 forms. I will not get into the details of that. IGF-1 and IGF-2 look very much like insulin, but they have a connecting peptide which is not split from the molecule like insulin is split from proinsulin into insulin and the separate C-peptide, and it has a little extension at the end called the D-domain. IGF-2 is not shown, this is IGF-1. Then it was found later that there are 7 peptides related to relaxin, which has also a similar structure, and relaxin is a hormone that was discovered in 1926 by Fred Hysaw in the United States, and which has an important role in reproductive physiology, but has no insulin-like effects. And then subsequent studies showed that, in fact, this family of insulin-like peptides is much bigger than those 10. We humans have 10, but if you go to a little worm called C. elegans, he has 37 different insulin-like peptides, which play a role in metabolism, reproduction, longevity, and a fly like Drosophila has 7 of them. And this is bombyxin from Bombyx, which is a silkworm, and it has also lost something like 26 insulin-like peptides. So it's a very big family. We think of insulin, glucose metabolism, and then maybe if you know a bit more IGF-1 and IGF-2 growth factors, it's actually much more complex, and it raises interesting questions because there is only 1 receptor in the worm. So in C. elegans, you have 37 peptides doing different things through the same receptor, and it's a big mystery right now for us, which we are trying to understand how you can get different effects through the very same receptor. So coming back a little bit now on the history of insulin itself, you know probably that it was discovered, or at least purified for the first time in 1921 into a form that could be given to diabetic patients. And that was done by Charles Best, who was a medical student, and Fred Banting, who was a young surgeon working in the laboratory of John MacLeod at the University of Toronto. And this feast of purifying insulin won them at least to Banting and MacLeod, the Nobel Prize in 1923. There were two other guys like Best and also the chemist Collip who helped purify the insulin, which could probably have deserved to share the Nobel Prize, but they didn't. But the two gentlemen shared the money with their colleagues, but that's still controversial today, whether only those two got it and not the others. Now, the discovery of insulin was a blessing for patients with diabetes, literally a miracle that saved them from dying, but it was also a blessing for protein chemists because almost every important discovery regarding protein structure was done using insulin as a model. And for example, insulin was the first protein to be sequenced by Fred Sanger in Cambridge, who got the Nobel Prize in 1958 for this. And then later he got a second Nobel Prize for finding methods to sequence DNA. And thanks to Fred Sanger, we know that insulin primary sequence looks like this. It has an A chain of 21 amino acids and a B chain with 30 amino acids. And they are linked by two disulfide bridges, and then there is an intrachain bridge in the A chain, 51 amino acids. Now, this sequence does tell us nothing on how the protein folds upon itself to acquire its active structure, that is the three-dimensional structure that will bind to the receptor on the cell and activate the receptor. For that, you needed X-ray crystallography, which was developed initially in Cambridge in the UK, and one of the pioneers was Dorothy Hodgkin, who had the Nobel Prize in 1964 for the structure of penicillin and vitamin B12, which are not proteins, but she dreamt of solving insulin, and she managed finally in 1969, and that was a great achievement. Now, thanks to the work of Dorothy Hodgkin, we now know exactly how insulin is folded in three-dimensional space. The A chain in blue has two alpha helices, while the B chain has one central alpha helix. And this is the active structure of insulin, which will bind to the receptors and tell the cells to take up sugar, take up glucose. And this is the monomer of insulin. This is the form which circulates in the blood. That's also what happens when you give it to cells in culture. Ultimately, this is the form that will make the cells grow. But in the beta cell of the pancreas, it is stored as a hexamer of six molecules. And for this, you require zinc, which must be present in the middle of the crystal. And this is how insulin is stored in the beta cell. This is also how insulin aggregates at very high concentrations. And it's a beautiful structure, I think. Now, thanks to the crystal structure, we also know exactly which amino acids of insulin are important for forming the dimers from two monomers, and this I call the dimer forming surface. And this is the part which is involved when three dimers form the hexamer, and we call this the hexamer forming surface. And I will show you later that insulin, in fact, uses pretty much those same two surfaces to bind and activate the receptor. It's a small globular protein, doesn't have that much surface to play with, so it kind of economically uses the same surfaces to do different things. IGF-1 does not aggregate, it remains always as a monomer, but its three-dimensional structure is very similar to that of insulin, with the A domain having two alpha helices, and then a permanent C peptide, which is here. In the crystal structure, it is missing a little piece. It is split by a protease, apparently, doesn't matter. And there is this D domain, but otherwise, it's a very similar